I just think it's a mistake. I think that we should keep it at that. But I don't know whether what my opinion matters anyway, but anyway, that's it. The 2098 is concerning.
Yeah.
I meet with a lot of attorneys, you know, past 1 year, and they have told me there are unscrupulous lawyers who will urge their women clients to file a 2098 to strengthen their case. So, as a judge, wouldn't you have 2 or 3 minutes to determine?
It's very hard. I think one of the things that you have to do is you have to give them as much time as they need under the circumstances. There's plenty of women that have been abused that come in before the court, and it's awful to see. You have to get those restraining orders. You have to find out whether or not they think that they're in fear and if there's good reason for them to think that. But you also have to parse out those ones, like you said, that there might be probate issue going on, or there might be some lawyer that's in the area saying this will help you if you do that. And I think that comes with experience, it comes with knowledge, and comes with being able to discern, or at least you hope you're able to discern whether the person's being truthful when they come in front of you. You just have to take it on a case-by-case basis.
Well, I don't want to tell the story of my life, but that's why I'm sitting here today, because of the 2098. I had a friend who was in a very, and I'm talking about a woman who lie. That was my question that I was presenting to you. How do you determine if it's just vindictiveness? But I know both sides. I had a friend who was in a very dangerous situation. And we couldn't understand why she got involved with this guy. We knew he was a bad guy. We knew it. And it got so bad, he was physically abusive, and she filed a 2098. She really feared for her life. There was no question. She continued to go to the courthouse seeking help from the judge, given that. She was going for the 8th time. My main husband was a firefighter, and a good friend of his who we worked along with, that he went to school with, a police officer, he asked him if he would accompany my friend at 8th time. And he did. And he said to the judge, "This is a dangerous man. She fears for her life. Give him a $200,000 bail." He got a $200 bail, turned to my friend, out of fear, she paid it. And the police officer, my friend, says, "The boyfriend was out the door before me." And the judge turned to my friend and said, "You know what? You're taking up our time, my time, and the court's time." And he really went on about it. 2 weeks later, she was dead. My friend was murdered by that criminal. And I'll be honest, I didn't know governor's counsel, because it doesn't even say governor on the ballot. So I said, "How does a judge get his job?" I don't know. I found out. And I said, "I've got the duties, because I didn't do that. You'll never be a judge like that on pitch." And so, empathy and compassion, besides experience and qualifications, and then what's one with me. And I found that in you. And I think we shared, that will go probably, but we both have shared having children with birth defects. And I believe that your experience with your children has made you more compassionate, more and more empathy. And so, having said all straight my life, now, I want to ask you, would there be any circumstances at all when you were in, if you were a judge, or the judge, would you turn off your recorder?
Yeah, wouldn't do it. I think it all should be public and all should be on record.
And if there was before you, non-citizen, known criminal, so many criminal acts that he was deported not once but twice, and now he's before you, and there's an ACE agent in a lobby in regular clothes, not in any uniform or badges or anything, and they have asked, he has asked to apprehend the this criminal, what would you do?
I certainly wouldn't get in the way in any way of what ICE is trying to do. If they were lawfully in the courthouse, which under those circumstances they certainly are, the courthouse is open to the public. If it's done in the correct way, which under your circumstance it would be, and this is something that they could take into custody, then that's their job. I respect that, and we can get in the way of it. And everybody in the court system has their function. They have their function. I respect that. And it's with the law under certain circumstances.
You've had so many cases, it's hard to pinpoint one. But is there anything that, any case that was most rewarding to you in your career?
Right. The one that I would point to is that in 1993, I tried a homicide right over in Southern Superior Court by representing a young man who went to trial and was acquitted of murder. I was a very young lawyer.
Is that the 17-year-old?
Yeah, that was the one that I think we could talk about.
Right.
Yeah, the kid has never been in trouble. He works, to the best of my knowledge, the last time I talked to him, he was working for the federal government in another state.
Wow.
Every now and again, I'd get a call about what this means on his query. It said murder, and next to it, it said NG. And that was the only entry there. And he came from a very, very nice family. He's the type of kid that could have had good job.
Excuse me, but you lost that case.
No, I won it. This is different.
The first one.
Yeah.
Okay.
I certainly lost enough of them. All right. But no, this is what I won.
Yeah.
And it was very rewarding to me to get to know him, to get to know his family, and to try a case. The prosecutor was Judge Mary Ames, who I just thought was just such a wonderful lawyer, and she's such a wonderful judge.
Judge Ames?
Yeah.
Very proud to
vote. Oh, that's.
And I have to tell you, you know, I did preface my remarks, and they are personal, how some people fly and a political person jumps the line. I think she was rejected twice before she came before us, and she sat over there because we had room before, and you could see all our eyes.
Right.
And but the thing was, I thanked her, and I said, thank you for, you know, for being persistent and reappointing, because this commonwealth would have lost a wonderful judge, you know, really. And so that's why I try to tell people, and it's hard to get my word out on this one person, if you have been rejected, apply again.
Sure.
Because you have the qualifications and experience, do it again. But some people just go away because they're so discouraged when they see who gets a job.
Yeah.
But she came back. She's doing
and she's better.
Yeah, really. But I have to tell you, you got the best tribute of me from Judge Michael
Pomeroy. Oh, that's
good. To me, just such a role model.
Oh,
I
yeah.
I mean, really.
A good guy.
And talking about the judge, I mean, I go back to him in the parole board.
Yeah.
He just shared. And he knew those people were going to be released. And he mandated courses for them. GED.
Right.
Marriage counseling.
Yeah. Fatherhood.
Anger management.
Right.
And he prepared these people to have education, to go out to society. And there was only 3% that came back under his watch. And I don't know of any parole board chair that has done that. And even coming here before that, and recommending certain legislation to legislators. So I mean, he had a whole
wonderful guy. Been a friend for a long time. I started in the DA's office when he started the week after. That's the chief of the PTs.
No, but he could say that.
All
that
things.
So you know, and he doesn't. He's not one to call. He doesn't do that. So that's a tribute
thank
to you.
Thank you so much.
So, okay, so now, what was the most disappointing case?
You know, I tried a homicide one time where I thought that the guy should have been acquitted. And he got convicted of second degree. And he went and he was did a wonderful job when he was inside, went into programs, worked. He's one of the few guys, I think, who actually paroled at 15 years, and he hasn't been rearrested, and I haven't heard anything about him. It was a disappointing verdict, but I think sometimes those happen. I respect the court system for what it is. I respect how it processed. And, but if I look back, if it was one case that I thought that I should have prevailed on and that I lost, it was that. And it was at this point to me at the time, and I was just so heartbroken for the kids' family.
And I don't think I mentioned it, of all the hours that we spent, but just to, and it has no reflection on my vote, but you graduated Boston College.
I did.
And I have two children, I'm like four that have graduated, and I have two grandchildren that graduated.
Oh, that's one.
Because I told you I was 10 when I got married.
Yeah, yeah.
But anyway, I have to say, it was such a pleasure. And for me, this is what I want to see. You know, I don't want to see six cases on a Superior Court, you know, for any reason, ethnic or whatever. You better vote for the person who's qualified, experienced, has empathy, has compassion, and hundreds of cases. And I mean, you've seen both sides, and you believe in second chances. And that means a lot, you know. And I think for the average person, just going before a judge is frightening. And so I think to have someone that can smile, that can be, you know, welcoming, yeah, that means a lot. And I have to add that I am so glad that they have judges now who are mentoring.
Yes.
We have needed that a long time, because I know I have heard and heard of judges who have been so rude to people, and I think that it's working. And so I'm glad for that. So it was just such a pleasure.
Thank
and I'm a pleasure. This is what a tribute.
Thank you, Brian. Yeah.
So
I'm very proud of
I've heard
this,
from
yeah,
so many people, and we've got letters
thank
and
you,
everything. So I didn't need any of that. I met you and I got to know you, and did my homework, and I'm very, very pleased.
Thank
very
you,
very pleased. And thank you again for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. You certainly do have a stellar reputation. Let me ask you this, and I apologize if someone's already asked you, but why do you want to be a judge?
You know, it's one of those things that's always in the back of my mind. I think it's the logical next step for trial attorney to at some point want to go on the bench. I want to go on the bench to return to public service, hopefully bring my experience and be helpful to people.
Mm-hmm.
Just it was the right time in my life to do it. My kids are more grown up now than they would have been 10 years ago. And it was the right time in our marriage. And it was just all things considered, this was the time, this is what I want to do, and I hope I can.
What, and if you want to share this, if you don't, that's fine. What life experience have you had?
One of the most important life experiences that I've had, and I've alluded to this, is in my role as a father. I have two special needs boys. My son Brian is autistic. He's taught me patience, teaches that to me every day, teaches me humility, and teaches me compassion. Allows Maureen and I, when we go out with them and we're in public, you see some people who want to come over and talk to them, and some people who shy away. It's the people that come over that teach me again what it means to be a human being, to see somebody who's less fortunate than you, and take the time to come over and try to get to know the person. Brian's had to get to know Maureen and his grandmother and all of us. It's taught me patience, I think, most importantly, and it's taught me humility. And I think those are two very important traits.
I wholeheartedly agree. I wanted to also tag on to something that Counselor Juvenville said about court reporters. The counselors know, but I don't talk about it a lot, but I was in panel on the jury 5 years ago. And it was stunning to me how I couldn't hear what people were saying. And it was and I would just raise my hand and stop the whole proceeding and say I can't hear. But there's absolutely no way that, and this was a court, this was Superior Court,
right,
and I'm sure the case was appealed. I cannot imagine how that recording device could ever pick up.
I don't think
the testimony.
I think that there's problems with it. I think that my friend Nancy King, who's still over there, and all of her other fellow court reporters have done a wonderful job so many times. After I've done a cross-examination, they'll come up to me and say, how do you spell that street?
Yeah.
Or if I'm giving an argument, how do you spell that case? What's the site that you said?
Well, I've learned a lot about this from Counsel Giglio, because I'm not an attorney. But you realize that it's really an impediment to justice to not have the court.
Yeah.
And, you know, as I've said so many times in these chambers, I get sick of listening to myself talk. But, you know, if we don't have that, we don't have access to justice and justice for all. And that's always been my big thing about the community courts. If people can't get to court, then what's the access to justice thing we're talking about? You like to write?
I do. I've come well with writing over the years, depending upon how busy I am with my trial schedule.
Mm-hmm.
I've certainly had assistance with William Gibson, Craig Mulcahy, who's over and back with good work with me over the years, and they've picked up a lot of the slack when I was on trial.
Yeah.
But I do enjoy writing, and I think it's one of the things that I most look forward to if I would be so fortunate to become a superior court judge. I know there's a lot of writing.
Well, that's why I asked.
Yeah.
Because there is a lot of writing. You know, in the unusual time our republic is in right now, I really truly believe that our state courts are our first line of defense. And the people that we're sending to the courts in Massachusetts right now are more important than they've ever been. Because there seems to be a real blurring of separation of powers on a federal level. And it is what we're based on as a country. And I use the word republic really truly meaning that. And so I have felt a heightened responsibility as we vet and approve and disapprove the governor's nominations. And I think that the writing is going to be more ominous probably because the words will be, you know, as they say, the bond and infamy.
Yeah, that's right.
It's really, we live in an unusual time that our Constitution will be tested in every possible way that it can be. I really don't have any further questions. I've heard a lot about you. I've done a lot of vetting with you. You're very well respected. You have a reputation for being humble, yet hardworking. I have great respect for criminal defense attorneys. I have great respect for people who take murder cases and the hard cases that other people maybe don't want to take. Maybe you take the case, you know, for whatever reason. You know, you don't think you can win it or whatever, but you do it because everyone in this country deserves representation, and even the most heinous people do. And that's hard for us to swallow sometimes.
I know.
It's, you know, but it is, we are, you know, up until, we still are a nation of laws. And it is it's important that we take these responsibilities. As I said, you know, I'm not trying to be over dramatic, but it is more important than it's ever been.
Oh, absolutely.
So anyway, thank you for applying.
Thank you.
I think it matters to have people with your background. I think the diversity in backgrounds matters a lot. And you're a great candidate.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Tim.
Can Counsel Keene left like another half hour that you want to say something?
I did. I forgot to tell you that Judge Pomeroy called me about you and wanted me to express his support for you. And Bob Grimes, the court officer.
Oh, sure.
Thank you. Well, I appreciate the conversation that you and I had earlier.
Thank
and,
you.
And someone spent 30 years of law enforcement. Yeah, now that I do some criminal defense work, certainly I'm astounded at how many trials you've done.
Yeah.
And your success and your reputation. I was with Judge O'Malley the other day who said, you're the best of the best.
Oh.
And I really respect his remarks. Your counsel, Terry Kennedy's to my left here, is a huge fan. So I don't really have any questions for you. You're going to have my support next week. I did note that you beat Judge Callow.
I think that was in front of your traffic.
That's why he's not here. I'm wondering about his temperament. I voted for him too. But
he's a wonderful guy. He talked to him the other day.
Yeah, thank you for applying.
That's it.
Good morning.
We talked on the phone, and it goes without saying, has tremendous reputation. The breadth of your experience is fabulous. My father was a defense attorney for 50 years in the Western Department of State, did the murder trials, and took the cases on case one. So it's in the BC.
Oh, that's
a
big deal. What is that?
In any event, just one question. The 4% civil experience that you have,
right.
What kind of cases were
those? Sure. When I was starting out my law practice in 1988, I took whatever came in the door. If it was personal injury, wind, left tenant, all different types of cases. As the criminal practice developed over the years, it's been less and less. There have been times where I've still had some cases in civil sessions, such as disputes between neighbors, personal injury cases, things of that nature. I haven't done a lot of civil in the last couple of years, but since over the last 3 weeks, I've sat down with some Superior Court judges who have criminal backgrounds and asked them how they were able to acclimate themselves into the civil session. Gave me some good advice and good tips. I sat down with John Powers, who's an assistant clerk in the civil session over on soccer, who used to be a prosecutor, and I tried to face with him. And I asked him what the most important things, the traits that he saw with judges that sat in civil sessions were. And it's very similar to the criminal sessions as well. You have to listen, you have to follow the law, you have to read the pleadings. It's something I look forward to getting myself
and you appeared in the Supreme Court.
I applied for cert there, but I've never gone to the U.S. Supreme Court. Penny Mulcahy and myself had a case a few years ago with one I unfortunately lost from the federal court that we applied for cert, and it didn't get a lot of value before the first cert.
All right, well,
I
think
that's
it. And just a tip from the judge, state the lawyers file post 90s memory.
It's very important, yes, I've been called that, yes.
Oh, and the first day that you're there, make sure you have a black robe.
Yes.
That's the case.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I apologize for being late. I had a hearing this morning. Well, we spoke on the phone. You were getting ready for your hearing with your host counsel, the chairman, this morning. I've heard just wonderful things about you, your background, obviously. Terry might think all these people are here to see him chair the hearing, but I'm pretty sure they're all here for you. Says a lot.
I think they're trying to get me in court.
Okay. But, you know, for me, your background is very impressive. Sometimes his job is very difficult, sometimes it's not so difficult. The lack of civil, if you will, where 95% of what you've done has been criminal, I think is, I always take the position that you can learn the civil. I think the criminal is so much more important, particularly in the Superior Court, where you're talking about people's freedom versus oftentimes just larger sums of money. So I think that is very important. We haven't seen a lot of nominees recently that have had more of the criminal. We've seen a lot of civil, so I'm happy to see that we're getting the balance back to the criminal side of it. What is your philosophy? We didn't have a chance to talk about this on the Second Amendment.
I support the Second Amendment. The law of the land, I support the Second Amendment. I think that the restrictions that we have in place to keep guns out of the hands of people who might have mental illness or criminal backgrounds don't work as well, unfortunately, as we might, but I certainly think that people have a right to bear arms.
Have you been asked, and I apologize if you've been asked, but what was the most difficult criminal case that you have handled in the course of your career?
The most difficult one that I've done was one killed the child. And the defense was, the prosecution's theory was that the boyfriend, my guy, had done it, and our theory was that the child's mother had committed the crime. It was a case that I learned a lot about myself.
Thank you.